In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, the Lord be with you. As we prepare ourselves to celebrate the Easter mysteries, let us call to mind our sins. I confess to Almighty God, and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have greatly sinned in my thoughts and in my words, in what I have done and what I have failed to do, through my fault, through my fault, through my most grievous fault. Therefore, I ask the Blessed Mary of the Virgin, all of the angels and saints, and you, my brothers and sisters, to pray for me to the Lord our God. Almighty God, mercy us, forgive us our sins and bring us to everlasting life. favour, O Lord, to your servants, and mercifully increase the gifts of your grace, that may fervently and full faith and charity, they may be ever watchful in keeping your commands. O Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, and listen unto me, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Who cares for everything, to whom you might ask the proof, Secondly, this particular seed spoken of in the parable of the wheat and the tares is called the
there that it dawned. There's a variety of ripe grass, and in its early stages of growth, it was indistinguishable from wheat. So you could not tell them apart. You did not know that it was not growing in your field. So it started to produce. By then, it was too late, because the roots would be interwoven, and to pull up the weeds would be to pull up the wheat. And thirdly, the seeds of the very darnel were poisonous. They would make you sick. The name comes from the French word darnel, which means stupefy. So the symptoms of eating darnel grain were dizziness, slurred speech, vomiting, and diarrhea. Preaching on this parable, St. John Chrysostom declared that it is not right to put a heretic to death, since an implacable war would be brought into the world, which would lead to the death of many saints. The Protestant reformer Martin Luther preached a sermon on this parable in which he affirmed that only God can separate false from true believers, and noted that killing heretics or unbelievers ends any opportunity they may have for salvation. My sisters and brothers, consider one thing today. Do not judge. Tommy Lane, reflecting on his gospel, asks, did you ever judge someone badly and discover later on that your judgment was incorrect? Anytime we judge others, he says, we need to be aware that we may not have the full picture and we may not be fair in our judgments of others. God is much more merciful and patient. In many apparitions of the Blessed Mother, she asks us to pray for the conversion of sinners. As Jesus once said on the cross, they know not what they do. Both Jesus and Mary remind us it is not for us to judge, but to pray for the conversion of sinners, that they come to know in a real way God's everlasting love for them, never seek to live in the presence of God, and follow after the way of Jesus Christ. Gregory Palamas knows the fact is that many godless sinners who live among people who are upright and devout, repent in time, and are converted, and by learning new habits of piety and virtue, they cease to become gone, and they become wheat. In other words, it is not for us to judge anyone. If we recall, the apostles and disciples were afraid of Saul, who had been arrested for who had arrested and put to death many Christians. But God had a plan for Saul. Saul had a great experience in Damascus and cooperated with God's plan for him. He was transformed into someone new, St. Paul the Apostle. Augustine had been living a hedonistic life, and yet God had plans for him. He became the great St. Augustine, Bishop and Doctor of the Church. In the Church's calendar yesterday, we celebrated St. Camillus de Lidus, whose mother died when he was about four. And his father pretty much abandoned him. He was never around. So Camillus ended up gambling at an early age and eventually lost everything that he had. Whatever jobs he had, he lost because he had a reputation for always quarreling and arguing with people. Yet through a conversion experience, he became a different person and served the poor, the sick, and all those hurt during the time of war in which he lived. He became known for his great compassion for all. His former gambler, who used to cuss and get on real bad, became a great saint. Sisters and brothers, we are all, every single one of us, on different stages of our journey. Jesus challenges us to not judge, to not decide for ourselves who is worthy and who is not, to not write people off, and most of all, we should not write ourselves off. Jesus recognized this tendency in his followers and warned them in Matthew 7, verses 1 to 2. Do not judge, lest ye be judged. So we're challenged today in the scriptures to leave that judgment to God himself. In the account of the woman caught in adultery, the Pharisees had already judged this woman, bringing her before Jesus, and they hoped to entrap him. Yet a simple response is that he who is without sin past the first stone. He challenges them and us. And when eventually they all leave one by one, he tells the woman, neither do I condemn you. Go in peace and sin no more. You know, those of us who come to church regularly must guard against entering into judgment of others and thinking that somehow we are better than other people, somehow more worthy than they are. Do not judge, lest ye be judged. The story is told of a man called An who was born into a wealthy family in Vietnam. He quickly spent a lot of what he had gambling, drinking, and using drugs. He even resorted to stealing from his own family, from other people. Eventually, he joined gangsters and ended up in prison. When he was free again, he slipped back into his old house and his old friends. The moment of truth eventually came when his mother caught him using drugs at home. She pleaded with God for his conversion. Many, many years later, he woke up. He realized what it is that he had been doing, repented of that lifestyle, and left drugs and the lifestyle behind. He reconciled with his family, who welcomed him back with open arms. 2 years later, he joined the Benedictines, and the family members could not understand just how much he changed until he and his former gangsters attended his ordination to the priesthood. He was now Father Han. They said they could not imagine that God could have called his prodigal son, his bad boy, to become a priest. That God believed in him. And since he came back to God, he's never looked back. And he has helped many people. One HIV positive man said that Father Han shared his story and taught him how much God loves sinners like me. He said everyone in his life gave up on him, including his own family. They turned their backs on him. Everyone that is except Father Han. And that's why he decided to become a Catholic. Sisters and brothers, Jesus shows us that no matter what sins we have committed, no matter what sins we are committing even now, it can be washed clean. There is no wrong that he will not forgive. You know, we live in a culture where we not only bad talk everyone, including our own family, we hardly ever say anything good about anyone. Father Thomas Lee notes, it is better for us to concentrate on removing the dogma in our own lives and judging others because of their dogma. Jesus is teaching elsewhere helps us. While you notice the splint in your brother's eye, but you do not perceive the plank in your own eye, what will you do, sisters and brothers, to remove the dogma in your life? There are several ways that we can do this. Living a spiritual life is the best way to remove the dogma from your life. That means having a life of continuous prayer, going to confession regularly, going to a daily mass if possible, works of charity, reading the Bible, etc., especially the Gospels. St. Teresa of Calcutta once said, when you judge your brothers and sisters, you do not have a chance to love them. Sisters and brothers, let's ask God for the grace to become more like his Son, Jesus Christ, to root out the dogma in our own lives, instead of judging and looking down on people. Let us choose to live virtuous lives loving as Jesus loves, so that by our example we can bring people back to God. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. We stand as we confess our faith. I believe in one God, Father the Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried, was ascended to God, and the third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended to heaven, and is seated at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. And they shall come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. And now before our Heavenly Father, all things are given.
Lord, bless.
Lord, gracious be there.
For farmers who have been gracious to hear us.
For the homeless, refugees, and those who are marginalized, that God will send persons to assist them. Lord, hear us.
Lord, gracious to hear us.
For the Carmelite province of St. Elias, that as the Levites of silent prayer and by the prophet Elijah, God will bless them with new vocations. Lord, hear us.
Lord, gracious to hear us.
For the sick and the shut-ins of the parish, that God will give them courage in their fear and faith to believe that it is merciful. Lord, hear us.
Salvation of all. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen.
of the world, and in your mercy you sent us to redeem, to live like us of all things for sin, so that you might love like us as you love in your Son, by whose obedience you have been restored to those gifts of yours that by in a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice and one small in hands, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink of it, for this is the chalice of my blood." giving thanks in your God's worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Now partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world. Together with Francis, our Pope, Jason, our Bishop, and all the clergy. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of resurrection and mercy, especially Elizabeth, Dulcie Heaven, Delmarie Walker, Albert Campbell, Marjorie Morgan, the partners of the Gerard Tang Choon mountains, along with their families, and all who have died of the coronavirus. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray. And with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, Blessed Joseph, your spouse, with the Blessed Apostles and glorious martyrs, the Campbellus, St. Paul, and all the saints, who have pleased you throughout the ages, you may merit the glorious eternal life, may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ.
Through him and for him and him.
Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb.
spiritual communion. My Jesus, I believe that you are present in the most holy sacrament. I love you above all things, and I desire to receive you into my soul. Since I want to receive you sacramentally, come at least spiritually. I embrace you as if you were already there. I said, holy to you. Never communicate with separately.
Is that an outside place? Thank you.
loves her. Graciously put present to your people, we pray, O Lord, and lead those who have imbued heavenly mysteries to pass from the former way to the newness of life. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
And then one visiting with us today for the first time, in a long while. Anybody who's celebrating a birthday this week or in the coming week? Birthday celebrants? Any anniversary celebrants? Weekend and a great rest of the day and a great week ahead. God bless. Stay safe.